like the calm after the storm. Tampa Stadium, home place of the Spartans, is peaceful again. Empty and still, the goalposts are down and stored. The great football battlefield is at rest. Where 46,000 sat and stood and cheered and wept, only the watchman passes now and then. And up here, the press box is empty too, and unbusy, and almost eerie, when you know how loud the clatter as the deeds of the Spartan 70 were being chronicled. We're number one. Sounds great, doesn't it? And what an honor to be named the number one small college football team in the United States, as were the University of Tampa Spartans. But no easy task was it for Coach Fran Kersey, now gone to the University of Miami, and his staff, when you know the quality of the opposition, North Texas State, Vanderbilt, Miami, Florida A&M. 100% effort was the requirement of the untried freshman and the dedicated fan. You'll see what I mean when we begin at the beginning with the kickoff against Delta State. The Spartan defense was on its toes from the very beginning of the season. As a matter of fact, the very first Spartan touchdown of the season was scored by the defense on this recovered fumble in the Delta State end zone. I'm celebrating here. And coming back quickly for the offense, Bruce Brown takes it in for a score. And with the defense back in, Harry Smith runs down the Delta State quarterback and causes this fumble. Eddie Caldwell has it at midfield for Tampa. And in possession, Paul Orndorff picks up some tough yards to set up a touchdown drive. Watch Buddy Carter, the quarterback on this one. He really has to scramble to get a pass off to Johnny Green. Here goes Leon X-Ray McQuay for his first touchdown of the season. The Spartans get their first win, 45-12 over Delta State. Next week against New Mexico Highlands, the Spartan defense will keep the pressure up. Now you'll notice that Tampa's not the least bit impressed by New Mexico's 20-game winning streak. Watch the defense at work. Noah Jackson had a good day. Now it's the offense's time against New Mexico. Quarterback Lou Pytel throws this pass. Watch this. New Mexico knew they went for a long night. Now mixing the air game with a strong ground game, Bruce Brown gets 5 yards. 5 tough yards. Here's Paul Orndorff as a pass receiver. And watch this run after he catches this pass. 1, 2, 3. Touchdown. Watch Sammy Gillerstadt, 61. A perfect tackle. Gillerstadt's an Alabama boy who came to Tampa and is happy about it. Harry Smith, another Tampa standout, throws New Mexico for a loss. Bankston's on it. It's end zone. This barefoot New Mexico kicker gets off a very short punt, and Pete Scaglione pulls it in, and then runs it to good field position for Tampa. Little conference. Quarterback Lou Pytel and running back Paul Orndorff take the scoring play in from Coach Fran Kersey. Here's another pitch to Orndorff around in as he scores his second touchdown of the game. Exit the hero, Paul Orndorff, Mayor of Brandon. In this series, Bruce Brown decides it's his turn for a touchdown. Great blocking here. Willie Miller takes the last man out. Here they go. And Tampa shuts out New Mexico Highlands 20-0. Now coming back from a 35-13 win over Youngstown, which gave Tampa so little opposition, there's no need to record it, the Spartans meet their first major foe, North Texas State. Big, strong, fast. What about Buddy Carter sends Paul Orndorff through the right side for 25 quick yards. What's that big fella mean? Now watch Leon McQuay running inside. From the six, the call goes to Bruce Brown, who takes it in. And the Texans find out they aren't able to fence in the Spartans. Wayne Jones gets some instructions from Jack Westbrook. Next defensive series. Obviously it was a good call, because watch Jones. Cut that pass reception to almost no gain. Watch Sammy Gillerstadt get to the quarterback. He didn't even have time to raise his hand. Going back to the offense, Kersey decides it's time to pass. The idea pays off as Buddy Carter connects first with Alex Edlin, who has some moves all his own. And then Carter finds freshman Mark Wakefield. 2 days later, Leon McQuay plunges over from the two with a score. Tampa has its fourth straight win, 18-7, over North Texas State. And Kersey gets a ride. Ecstatic over his win over North Texas State, Fran Kersey takes his team to the University of Miami, his own alma mater. This was to be the biggie. This was to be the one they had to have. And nervous, they head for the Orange Bowl. Here their equipment goes on the big plane as they head for the Magic City and the Magic Game. Here's David DeLo, president of the university. He and his wife went along, and Kersey and his wife. And arriving on the Gold Coast, they were met by literally hundreds of Tampa boosters who were there. The truth of the matter is, over 3,000 went down. They didn't go down to live it up on the Gold Coast and in Miami and on the beaches. They went to cheer their Spartans on to what would be the most significant victory in the history of the University of Tampa. And here they go into the Orange Bowl, the biggest game ever for Tampa. Leon McQuay gave it to him quick, putting Tampa ahead early in the first quarter with this touchdown. And here's some of the defense that Miami would be faced with all night long. Now watch this play. Watch this run back of a touchdown by Wayne Jones. You'll never see a better. You don't think there was some happiness there? Watch this defense that Tampa kept up all night long. And And here comes an interception by little Joey Clark. Great play. Turn the game around. Paul Orndorff, around in. He starts the next drive with this. Hot combination all night was Buddy Carter, passing to in Mark Wakefield, who glides when he catches the ball. Touchdown, Mark Wakefield. 24-8 at that point. There was no stopping Tampa this night. Those V's don't mean peace. They mean victory for Tampa. It was building. Here, Buddy Rayburn, also of Brandon, picks off a key interception of Kelly Cochran. Pass. And here's a pass to Willie Miller, who can't be stopped for a while after he catches the pass. And Buddy Carter decides to take this one in himself. Round in. Option play. Final score, Tampa 31, Miami 14. The dressing room, Rick Bedman. And back home, the number one team in the nation. Greeted by the mayor, Dick Greco, and Sam Mirabella, a councilman there behind Greco, and a great longtime friend. Rolling now with a five-game winning streak. Xavier just can't handle the Spartans. Watch Leon McQuay. He's off on an 82-yard touchdown run. Picking him up, putting him down. Sadly, there was a penalty. It's called back. Now watch Tampa on defense. Xavier went nowhere. Now Leon makes up for the play that was called back. 18 yards for a touchdown. Bruce Brown floats the last 3 yards for a touchdown. The Spartans win this one easily, 33-10. And they're in the clouds, just as is Bruce Brown, floating to this touchdown. Next, it was on to Ruston, Louisiana, and Louisiana Tech. Watch the Spartan defense. It was defense all the way in providing a 14-10 win. The defensive team had maybe its greatest night of the season. People like Gellerstadt, Tomio, Hernandez, Reynolds. In the secondary, like Eddie Caldwell. Just what he's supposed to be. Takes that batted interception back to midfield. It was 14-10, Tampa, and 7-0. The next Saturday, it was back to Louisiana. And back-to-back Saturdays in Louisiana is a challenging quinella. This time, it was offense. This time, it was Leon McQuay night. There he is, turning the corner on his greatest single night as a Spartan. That was his first touchdown. Here's his second, the second of five. He was tough that night because he heard the Louisiana coach say on television he wasn't. He caught passes too. One more time. Catch 22. It's clear why he was chosen first team Little All-America after seeing this matchless performance in the 50-38 win over a good Southwestern Louisiana team. Returning to Tampa, the Spartans took on Idaho State in the rain. This was kind of a mystery team they faced. That's Paul Orndorff digging in the middle. Leon McQuay played against Idaho too. Here he is, making his way. In his career so far, and in his career ahead, Leon McQuay will have many runs. None will be more classic than this.
way again. Another touchdown. Laying the ball down gently. Crowd loved it. The extra point by Jesse Soper, just as he kicked the others. The defense stopped Idaho State cold. Up front, and in the secondary, watch Joey Clark return this interception 25 yards and get hit. That's Hal Dunbar, backup quarterback, passing to DeKevin McCarty of Auburndale for touchdown. Now McQuay gets back in for a little workout. 31 yards out. Number 42, freshman running back Ken Moorhead. He can move it too. Now Dunbar passes to Johnny Green for a touchdown. Johnny Green of Tampa dives it. 68-7 over Idaho State. Next week it was to be Vanderbilt and homecoming. And homecoming is many things to many people. It's a week of celebration for the 2200 University of Tampa students, and these are exemplary of those. But it continued to be a time for study, because that doesn't stop. And the day-to-day routine of campus life, that's the cafeteria. And that's the campus. And those are the spires. Maybe there's not a university in the world with architecture so unique as this. Tampa number one. Because Vanderbilt is a member of the Southeastern Conference, the game contract with Tampa stipulated player eligibility be determined by those SEC rules. That meant five Tampa players could not play. Two of them were Sam Gillerstadt and Dave Tomeo, both regulars and named honorary captains. They went out for the coin toss. The game would feature runs like this by Willie Miller. And on this early pass of Buddy Carter to Mark Wakefield, the result foreshadowed the outcome. Wakefield didn't quite make it. 36,000 people. Despite the opposition, the SEC opposition, the great Leon McQuay managed to grind out two touchdowns and 155 yards. Coach Bill Pace of Vanderbilt said he was the greatest runner they'd faced all year. Here's a McQuay touchdown. The Tampa defense put on the pressure. And it too drew praise from Vanderbilt. Here's a Tampa touchdown. Paul Orndorff. After leading at the half, the Tampa defense continued to put on the pressure and caused fumbles like this one. That's Gillerstadt. He couldn't play. The final Spartan score was set up by this pass to Orndorff. Watch it. Now this Buddy Carter pass to Mark Wakefield, who tight ropes it on the end zone, put Tampa ahead, 28-20, pretty late in the game. For number one. The Spartan defense put pressure on Vanderbilt, stopped a drive, and forced a field goal. It was 28-23, still late in the game. And despite efforts like that, Vanderbilt still moved ahead and took a 36-28 lead. Even in the final minutes of the game, this good Spartan defense forced a fumble. There was still time for 8 points in a tie. Leon McQuay gets a few yards. hand this pass to Alex Edlin. The Spartans were moving close. And here was the last one, a 40-yard effort thrown to Mark Wakefield in the end zone. He couldn't hold it. And the number one Spartans tasted defeat for the first time. 36-28 Vanderbilt, the first loss. The Long Walk by Ron Mikolochek. That tells the story. But like the scoreboard says, the next week means another game. Tampa faced interstate rival Florida A&M for the final game of the season, and it was something. Tampa Stadium, 45,000 people. And on the heels of the Vanderbilt defeat, the Spartans bounced back with a runaway victory over the Rattlers, 49-7. It may be the final game of the season, but what makes this action exciting is knowing that most of these boys will be back in 1971. Defensive standouts such as 61, Sam Gillerstadt, 21, Wayne Jones, 32, Dave Tomeo, 87, Harry Smith, they'll be back. And you'll be seeing more passes like that to Alex Edlin. And of course, Leon McQuay, he'll be back. Running behind Dave Grant in 56 and Ron Herbie in 62. And some of the others you'll see back under new head coach Bill Fulcher, the wide receiver Mark Wakefield, Ron Mikolochek, place kicker Jesse Soper, Paul Orndorff, Fletcher Carr, Ken Moorhead, Johnny Green. And there'll be another big season for big opponents. Florida A&M, Drake, Vanderbilt, Archie Manning's Ole Mississippi. That's right, the University of. And yet even the prospect of this season coming up will be hard-pressed to match the events of the Spartans 70, such as the glory of the win at Miami by Fran Kersey's team over Fran Kersey's old team. And of course, Leon McQuay's 1,300 yards rushing. And the record-breaking crowds who fill Tampa Stadium week after week. The season, the brutality and the beauty, the pride and the passion, the agony and the ecstasy was part of the grandest season ever for the University of Tampa. 10-1, the Spartans 70. And the most precious memory of all, we're number one.
Big-time players, fans, and schedule. NCAA membership. Tampa goes big time indeed. Big-time gridiron competition, everything has to work right. There's no room for mistakes. Tampa's goal of an unbeaten 1971 season was most ambitious, especially against the likes of Louisville, Vanderbilt, and Mississippi. Backed by a new administration, upgraded facilities, and a new big-time look, the brash Spartans from the banks of the Hillsborough River sought this ultimate dream. But this dream would not come true. It was one of those years. The elusive pigskin, some bad breaks, and those ever-present turnovers would just make too much difference during the year. ¶¶ Despite having to settle for a disappointing 6-5 record, the proud Big Red played some great games. They gave 110% effort and played the only way they knew how, to win. This gutty team never gave up, and their season could easily have been 8-3 instead of 6-5. There were simply too many times when nothing seemed to go right. Individual effort and spectacular plays, however, more than made up for the unhappy scenes. Tampa Stadium fans were thrilled time and time again by the exciting, hard-hitting brand of football they've grown to expect from their Spartans. Sorry about that, son. All-American Sammy Gellerstadt's familiar quickness and gesture. An awesome defensive rush. Bone-jarring tackles like this one by Dave Tomeo. These are typical of the fine Tampa defensive team and their Super 71 performance. With second and third individual efforts, the defense made believers out of opposing quarterbacks and ball carriers. Spartan defensive backs also were superb as they covered receivers and backed up the line. Sacking the quarterback or stopping a play in the opposition's backfield became a specialty and a delight for the quick, hard-charging Big Red defense. As all opponents quickly found out, it was really tough to run against Tampa's stout line. Here's some convincing evidence. Shows effective defense pressure as the ball is coughed up and alert linebacker Dave Bankston gets 6 points against Florida A&M. As you follow the action now, you can pick out the outstanding performers. Like this interception by Eddie Caldwell. You'll spot pro draft choice number 88, Bobby Brown, in on many fine tackles, along with teammate Wilbur Grooms, number 83. Willie Lee Jones, number 90, another pro draftee, and a favorite of the crowd, was often in on the action also. Other outstanding defensive players deserving mention include number 82, John Matusak, number 87, Harry Smith, number 59, Tom Haynes, number 74, Ron Sporlein, number 58, Tom Whitmer, number 72, Mike Hernandez, number 21, Wayne Jones, number 43, Rick Thomas. They were all in there. Number 38, Joey Clark, did a yeoman's job handling the punting game, averaging nearly 39 yards a kick for the season. He also did a fine job in the secondary. Here's a tribute to every member of the fine defensive team. Thank you. watch the middle of the line on this next play as Gellerstad goes underneath the center to block a Mississippi field goal attempt. Wow, what a defense. What a tackle. Another interception by Eddie Caldwell, and a run back for excellent yardage. That's what Spartan defense was all about in 1971. Now for a look at some highlights of the Tampa offensive unit, such as freshman Alan Pittman's running, and that of number 26, Willie Miller. This is Freddie Solomon, fleet-footed freshman quarterback, going 78 yards for a touchdown. That's just one of several you see him break. Here's a Buddy Carter touchdown pass. Fullback Paul Orndorff is tough, whether it's a handoff up the middle or the receiving end of a pass. Poetry in motion, Solomon style. And it's rapid motion. Another kind of poetry here, in slow motion, punishing motion. The offensive line provided great protection when called on and carried out blocking assignments to break the speedy backs loose. Ken Moorhead, sophomore running back, gets a call on this play, gets a good block, and the touchdown. Jesse Soper converted on 35 of 40 extra points and made 10 of 12 field goals. But none of them made him or the fans any happier than this 50-yard field goal, a Tampa Stadium record. That's how it feels. The explosive Spartans stacked up 329 points with a total of 19 players sharing the scoring honors for the year. That averages 29.9 points per game. The opposing teams could only muster half that much by comparison. Sit back now, watch and enjoy some of the super runs, passes, and spectacular catches. Like this one to split end Mark Wakefield. Steady Buddy Carter had a fine year at quarterback. Freshman Freddie Solomon is a constant threat for the long game. Morris LeGrand, number 27. Frank Pitts, number 33. And Ernie DeBose, number 45. They all have outstanding futures. Bob Springer, a sophomore receiver, did an outstanding job. Along with old pros, number 85 of Wakefield, number 80 Edlin, and number 81, McCarty. They have great moves and made difficult catches look easy. A tremendous amount of talent and experience returns for the 1972 Spartans. The offense is scheduled to return almost to the man. One more time, as Solomon fakes right, then around left end for another score. This 95-yard pass play set a stadium record. It was Carter to Wakefield all the way. That's Spartan big time offense. It was daring, wide open offense that provided the thrills and excitement that fans came to see in 71. Over 165,000 of them cheered and rooted for the Spartans last year at Tampa Stadium. It should be a great year for 1972 under new head coach Earl Bruce. Among the Spartans who return for next season is Buddy Carter, slated for his final year at quarterback. Wilbur Groom, 6'3", 220-pound defensive end, returns for his senior year also. Along with Harry Smith and John Matusak, both defensive line stars return to the 72 Spartan team. Rough, tough Paul Orndorff will be back. Freddie Solomon will only be a sophomore. Fullback Ernie DeBose returns with two more years of eligibility. Fast Eddie Caldwell, a defensive back of the first order, he's coming back. Also returning is Dave Grantham, one of the best offensive guards. Alex Edlin, 6'1", tight end, has great moves in hand. He'll use them in 72. Fletcher Carr, a great all-round athlete, will be back at his usual job at center. Ron Mikolojak signed to play pro ball. He would have returned. Mark Wakefield, a super receiver, has 2 years. He'll catch many more Spartan passes. Ken Moorhead, another sophomore who scored 4 touchdowns late in the year. He'll be back. Alan Pittman, outstanding freshman, will return as a great asset to the backfield. Flanker Bob Stringer still has 2 more years. He can keep up with the best. A great returning nucleus of experienced players for next year. Bolstered by their newly acquired NCAA membership, the 1972 Spartans move into more big time. Opening September 9th against Toledo University, unbeaten in 35 games. Powerful Kansas State also is a newcomer to the 9-home game schedule, which also will see Florida A&M return for a rematch, and Vanderbilt comes back for their 3rd meeting. Except for plays like this 95-yard punt return against Vandy, the record would have been different. This one was called back because an official called it a clip. Most fans thought it was a picture play block, just like he was taught. The final score might have been different, and so might the season. But that's big time football.